Good afternoon to one and all. Today we'll continue the section on water treatment. Last class we have seen about water quality parameters, water quality indices, etc. And we also have discussed about sedimentation and how to design the sedimentation tank and what are the different types of sedimentation systems. Today we'll focus on coagulation, flocculation and filtration. So when we need coagulation and flocculation. Coagulation and flocculation is needed when the impurity is present in the water. The size of the particles are less because water will be having different size of particles starting from suspended solids to colloidal solids to dissolved solids. Okay, and we can see that as I have mentioned here, six orders of magnitude of particles are present in the water, and colloidal particles, when they are present in the water, sedimentation is not effective. So we have to aggregate the small particles into larger particles, then only the settling time will be reasonable. So plain sedimentation is effective only if the particle size is more than 50 micrometer. Of course, the density also will be playing a significant role, but if the particle size is less than 50 micrometer, the time needed for settling is very, very high. You can see here, I have taken the particle diameter and typical size of the particle and settling velocity I have given here. You can see that a pebble, the diameter is around 10 millimeter, that means a centimeter. The settling velocity is around 0.73 meter per second, that means it travels around 73 centimeters per second. Okay, it's very high settling velocity. When it comes to coarse sand, the settling velocity is 0.23 meter per second. Fine sand, again it is reducing. And you see, here, large colloid, the particle size is around 0.0001 millimeter. That means 0.1 micrometer. So the settling velocity is around 0.3 meter per year. So imagine you wanted to design a plain sedimentation tank for this type of a particle. How much of size we have to give? It is not economical or it is not feasible. So, in such cases, plain sedimentation will not work. We have to modify the particles in such a way that they will aggregate together. So, the size of the particle will increase and the settling velocity will be reasonably high so that sedimentation will take place properly. And when we talk about coagulation and flocculation, we should understand a little bit about colloids and colloidal stability. Colloidal suspensions are stable suspensions. That means this colloidal suspension, most of the time they will not be agglomerating. The reason is the colloidal particles are such a tiny particles, so their surface area to volume ratio is very, very high. So surface phenomena predominates over the mass phenomena. So because they have large surface area, accumulation of electric charges on particle surface is very common. And if you see the water, especially the surface waters, most of the colloidal particles are negatively charged. So, since these particles are very small and the surfaces are charged, it is very difficult to bring them together. Unless they become or they come together and form flocs, the settling will not be possible. So, this represents a colloidal particle. You can see that this hatched portion, this portion is the colloidal particle. Since it is having some charge, I told you most of the colloids in surface water is negatively charged, and the water is having so many other cations and anions. So because of this charge of the particle, lot of ions will be getting attached or coming closer to these colloidal particles. Okay, you can see that many positive counter ions and co-ions and a diffused ionic layer will be there, around the colloidal particle. So since this type of a thing is there, and imagine another colloidal particle somewhere here, this is also will be having so many ions together. Bringing these colloidal particles together is very, very difficult. So this shows how the diffused, this is the center of the colloidal particle. And you can see that diffused layer is expanding to a larger distance. And then you have the bulk solution. So another ion can come only up to this vicinity, because other ions, these counter ions and co-ions will be forming a diffuse layer like this. So, bringing these two colloidal particles are almost impossible. So that is why we are going for this coagulation and flocculation. So when we see the forces acting on the colloidal suspension, okay, is one is electrostatic potential created by the halo of counter ion surrounding each colloid. Okay, this will be causing a repulsive force because you have a negative colloidal particle which is having negative charge, and because of the negative charge, the positive ions, whatever is present in the water, it will be coming and forming a layer around the colloidal particle, then opposite charge, then a diffuse layer. So this layer will be causing a repulsive force. And as all of you know, van der Waals force, okay, it's a weak attractive force. Okay, this will also be acting on the colloidal particle, but we know that van der Waals force is inversely proportional to the distance. That means 1 by d raised to 6. D is the distance between two colloidal particles. So if you can bring the colloidal particles, okay, somewhat close by, then this van der Waals force of attraction will be coming into picture and the colloidal particles will start agglomerating. So how can we bring the colloidal particles together? So that is what we are doing in coagulation. See, okay, you have the repulsive force, I have represented like this, and this is the attractive force. So this is the net force. The net force should be enough in such a way that the colloidal particles can come together. Otherwise, what will happen? The particles will never ever agglomerate together. So this energy barrier we should overcome the energy barrier and make the net force as attractive force, then only the coagulation will happen. Hope it is clear. So you have a repulsive force and an attractive force. Attractive force is weak van der Waals force, and this is inversely proportional to the distance between the colloidal particles. In fact, it is 1 by d raised to 6. So if you can bring the colloidal particles close by each other, then the chances of the particles getting attracted to each other and agglomerating will be high. So how can we make the net force, or how can we overcome the energy barrier and make the net force attractive? That is what is done in coagulation. Okay, so once we have to modify the surface energy, then we have to do the colloid to move together to get agglomerated. So that is what is happening in flocculation, the movement and attachment. So here I have shown you the bulk distance. This is the diffuse layer, this is the distance between the particles. So if the distance between the particles decreases, the attractive force will dominate the repulsive force. Otherwise, it will be vice versa, the other way. When we add coagulants, the surface chemistry of the colloids will be getting modified. So when we talk about coagulants, the most commonly used coagulant in water treatment is alum, Al2SO4 thrice, 17H2O or 5H2O depending upon the salt, or other metal ions like ferrous sulfate, ferric chloride, etc. also can be used as coagulants. And we will see how this coagulation is occurring. Mainly the coagulation is happening, or how the colloidal particles are coming together. So this is happening in four different mechanisms or four different ways. First one is ionic layer compression. Second one is adsorption and charge neutralization. Third one is entrapment in a flocculant mass. And fourth one is adsorption and interparticle bridging. So we will see each of this mechanism in detail, so that it will be clear to you how this coagulation is happening. Because you will be thinking that just add alum, the flocs are forming. Okay, actually it is much more complex. In ionic layer compression, what is happening? Because earlier we have seen that you have a colloidal particle and a diffuse layer as a tail, it is there. So, and we wanted to bring two particles together. So if one particle's the tail end or diffuse layer is too long, and bringing two particles will be very, very difficult. And you know that the van der Waals force will be effective when the particles are close to each other. So if this diffuse layer, if you can compress it, so then what will happen? The particle can come together much easier. So that is what we are doing in ionic layer compression. So ions surrounding a particle function of electrostatic potential. So if you have high ionic concentration in the solution, it compresses the counter ion layer. So if the layer is sufficiently compressed, van der Waals force dominate and particle get attached. I'll show you here. See, this is the diffuse layer. This is the diffuse layer of counter ions and co-ions. So what we are doing is we are increasing the ionic strength of the solution. So what will happen? The concentration of these ions will be increasing here. So your diffuse layer distance, okay, will be reducing. Okay, say instead of up to here, it may come up to here. So another particles can come close by this one, and the van der Waals force will be, okay, predominating the repulsive force, and the particles can agglomerate. That is ionic layer compression. Second one is adsorption and charge neutralization, because we have seen that colloidal particles are having negative charge. If it doesn't have any charge, then you will not be having this diffuse layer and all the things. Then it will be easy to make the colloidal particles to come together. So here, okay, that is what is happening. Okay, you are adding alum, Al2SO4 thrice, to water. Then it will be dissociating to form aluminium ions and sulfate ions. And aluminium ion react with water to form aluminium, AlOH2+, okay, AlOH, Al7OH17, like that, lot of anions will be formed. So all these things are positively charged. You can see that Al3+ is positively charged. All these things are positively charged, and this is the precipitate, Al aluminium hydroxide. So these positively charged ions will go and get attached to the colloidal particle. So what will happen? The colloidal particle will become neutral. So there will not be any repulsive force. If repulsive force is not there, the van der Waals force of attraction will come as the major force between the colloids, and the colloidal particles will be getting attached to each other. So that is what I have written here. These aquametallic ions having high affinity to colloidal particles get attracted to colloidal particles and get attached to them and neutralize the surface charge. As a result, the ionic cloud disappears. Okay, but we have to be extremely careful. If you give overdose, then what will happen? More and more these aluminium ions or this aquametallic ions will be getting adsorbed on the colloidal particles. So instead of the negative charge, it becomes positive charge. Then again the particles will start repelling. So this is why optimum dose of coagulant and all are very, very important to get a proper result. Then the next mechanism is seep coagulation. So here what is happening is, when we add alum or any other coagulant agents to water, it will be forming metal hydroxides. So this metal hydroxides will be precipitating, and this precipitate will be settling down. Along with the precipitate settling down, the colloidal particles also will be settling down. So that is what is happening in seep coagulation. So that's why it is known as seeping, just like cleaning. So you have a layer of this metal hydroxide flock. So that flock will be settling down. Along with that flock, it will be seeping down all the coagulant, all the colloidal particles, and the water will become clean. And the rate of precipitation will be depending upon concentration of salts, concentration of anions, concentration of colloidal particles, etc. Okay, we'll see this one in detail little later. The last mechanism, or the fourth mechanism, is adsorption and interparticle bridging. So here we use, when we use synthetic organic polymers or coagulant aids, it will be having the branch surfaces. So the colloidal particles will be getting attached to this branch surfaces, and many colloid particles will be getting attached to a chain, and all the things will be settling down. But high coagulant dose destabilization can happen, and low concentration, it is insufficient. So optimum dosage of coagulant is essential here also. This is what I told. This is the polymer chain, and this is your particle. Destabilized particle is getting attached here. So if you have more of this one, this destabilized particles get together and form the flocks. But if you have more coagulant or this polymers, what will happen? This chain, each one is a functional group. It will be getting entrapped in the colloidal particle get entrapped there, and the charge or restabilization of particle will be happening. And you can see that this is another flock. if the flock, if you have last mixing, okay, intense mixing, then what will happen? These flocks can split it into different things. Okay, so this is a flock fragment. Again, restabilization will occur. So, optimum coagulant dose of this polymer, polymeric material is very, very essential to get a proper coagulation. So, how can we find out the optimum coagulant dose? For that one, we use JAR test. Okay, so coagulation is not an exact science. So, selection of optimum coagulant dose, okay, you have to do laboratory experiments, because the optimum coagulant dose depending upon the water quality, the alkalinity present in the system, nature of the coagulant, amount of coagulant present, temperature, all those things will be, okay, affecting the optimum coagulant dosage. So that's why, okay, we cannot theoretically calculate the optimum coagulant dose. So we have to go for this JAR test. So in JAR test, what we do, we will be having a series of test tubes, beakers. I'll show you that one. We will be having the rapid mixing for about 1 minute, slow mixing around 15 to 20 minutes, and settling time 30 minutes. So this is a JAR test apparatus. You can see that here you have the thing, okay, and minimum 6 beakers, and you have a, okay, speed controller and all here, okay, to control the mixing RPM. So what you have to do is you take the colloidal part, the water containing water to be treated in different beakers, the same quantity, and add different doses of coagulants to this one simultaneously and mix. Rapid mixing, as we have seen earlier, rapid mixing for 1 minute and slow mixing for 15 to 20 minutes and settling for 30 minutes. And after 30 minutes, take the supernatant and measure for the turbidity. So the dose which is giving the lowest residual turbidity, that is the optimum coagulant dose. And in treatment systems and all, we have to calculate the optimum coagulant dose on daily basis, because it will be varying depending upon the temperature, nature of the water, colloids, etc., as I explained earlier. So coagulation and flocculation, how it is behaving for different types of, okay, waters, or how the coagulation occurs for different turbidity. Okay, so here I can explain. Okay, here the concentration, colloidal concentration S1 is very less, S2 is more than S1, S3 is higher than S3, S2, and S4 is the highest concentration. Okay, different turbidity. So what is happening? If the turbidity is very less, what will happen? If you add the alum, the coagulant, your adsorption and charge neutralization may happen, but the particle number or the density of particles in the water, okay, the number of particles in water is very less. So even the stabilized particles are there, okay, these particles have to come together, okay, to form the flocks. So but if the number of particles are very less, even because of the Brownian motion, the particles coming together will be very, very rare. So coagulation will not be very effective initially, unless we increase the coagulant dose significantly so that the steep coagulation can occur. So that is the condition for low turbid water. And here what is happening, the colloidal concentration is slightly higher. So you have some charge neutralization and coagulation is happening, but as the coagulant dose increases, charge reversal happen. So your turbid particles concentration increases, and again steep coagulation. So if the colloidal particle concentration is still higher, here charge neutralization, coagulation occurs, then again charge reversal, no coagulation, and again coagulation. And if the particle concentration is very, very, very high, okay, adsorption and charge neutralization will be very, very effective. So that is what is shown here. And okay, this also shows the same thing, colloidal concentration and optimum coagulant dose. Don't think that coagulant dose is directly proportional to the turbidity of the water. In fact, it is the other way. It is almost inversely proportional to the turbidity of the water. I cannot tell it is linear, but here you can see that when the colloidal concentration is high, the dosage is low. Okay, here itself the coagulation is start occurring, but if the turbidity is very, very less, optimum coagulant dose is very high. Okay, because at this time only steep coagulation mechanism will be working. Here adsorption, charge neutralization, etc. will be effective. And another important factor to be considered for coagulation is alkalinity. You may be thinking why alkalinity is very important. Okay, because metallic salts are nothing but hydrated metal ions. They are weak cationic acids. They release H plus ions. So when H plus ions get released, the pH of the water will be coming down. But if you want to have sweep coagulation or aluminium hydroxide formation, the pH should be relatively high. So if initial alkalinity is low, it will be difficult to attain the coagulation. So that is the reason why sometimes we add lime along with alum to get a proper coagulation. So if you want to get a hydroxide flock formation, the pH should be above 7. So when we use different coagulants, alum you will be getting a pH of 5 to 7. Ferric chloride, the pH is up to 4.5. ferrosulfate above 9.5. This is the different coagulants and the pH range usually encountered. And in water treatment, the coagulant dose usually varies from 5 to 50 milligram per liter. And again, I am telling, this will be depending upon the turbidity and nature of the water. Now, the water can be classified into four groups with respect to coagulation and flocculation. One is high turbidity, low alkalinity water. High turbidity, low alkalinity water, low coagulant dose is needed. The reason is, this type of a water, the major mechanism for coagulation will be adsorption and charge neutralization. So if your alkalinity is less, most of the aluminium ions present in the water will be in the form of cations. So the charge neutralization will be effective and the coagulation will be happening. The second group is high turbidity and high alkalinity. Since high alkalinity is there, sieve flocculation is or sieve coagulation is possible. So the pH will not be getting affected. So this one also will be easy to treat. Now we'll see the third group of water, low turbidity and high alkalinity. Here also the coagulation mechanism is sieve coagulation. Since the alkalinity is very high, metal hydroxide formation will be happening and the sieve will be the flocks will be, or aluminium hydroxide flocks will be seeping all the colloids, and you will be able to get a good results. But if you want to improve the efficiency, you can add more colloidal particles and get a better results. And group 4, this is the most difficult water to treat, low turbidity and low alkalinity. Most difficult water to treat, low colloidal concentration, coagulation is difficult, low alkalinity, because of that one, aluminium hydroxide formation is difficult. So what we have to do, either convert it into group 3 or group by adding alkalinity or alkalinity and turbidity together, so that adsorption and charge neutralization of sieve coagulation will be happening and coagulation will be easy. So I hope it is clear to you. Water can be classified into four different categories. The most difficult water to treat is low turbidity and low alkalinity. It's all depending upon the mechanism of coagulation. We have decided the chemical and we have seen the mechanism how the coagulation is happening. So when we add the chemical, we have to make sure that the chemical is getting distributed in the water uniformly. So that is the reason we are going for the rapid mixing. So to achieve uniform coagulation and uniform mixing of chemicals. So design parameters are the mixing time T and velocity gradient. And what is this velocity gradient? It is nothing but the relative velocity with respect to distance. The unit is T inverse. Velocity gradient is usually expressed in terms of power dissipation per volume. So velocity gradient usually represented as G. G is equal to P is the power input divided by V into mu raised to half. Where P is the power given to the system, V is the volume of water or volume of mixing basin, and mu is the viscosity of water to the power half. So if you give more power, you will be having more G value and the mixing will be okay faster. Okay, but okay, we have to be extremely careful. If you prolong this rapid mixing, your flocks will be getting okay broken and your coagulation will not be effective. Rapid mixing G value usually selected is around 700 to 1000, and the time, maximum time usually given for rapid mixing is 2 minutes, because the purpose is uniform distribution of chemicals, okay, and uniform coagulation. And there are mechanical devices just like the inline blenders, okay, just a mixing, or like your mixie. So here the T whatever is given for the rapid mixing is less than 1 second, because the G value is very very high. It varies around 3000 to 50,000 per second. And rapid mixing unit, the G value, total G value needed is 700 to 1000. So if your G value is in this range, G into T, okay, so that is energy this one needed, okay, that can be reduced significantly. So you can see, okay, this is the coagulation and flocculation devices. This is the direction of flow. You are adding the chemical, and this is the rapid mixing units. Okay, now we'll see what is flocculation. So coagulation is clear, the chemical addition to change the nature of the colloidal particles so that they will be destabilizing to come closer to each other so that we can remove them effectively. So what is happening in flocculation? Flocculation, how are we bringing this destabilized particles together to form the floc? Okay, destabilization is coagulation, and bringing the destabilized particles together, okay, to separate it from the liquid, that is known as flocculation. So flocculation, okay, what we are doing is create turbulence to promote collisions of particles, okay, because you have many many particles. So if you give more turbulence, the chances of particles colliding with each other will be very high, and the particles will be separating from the solution. Here also the turbulence is achieved by providing velocity gradients, and descent parameter is G into T, and it is a dimensionless okay parameter. And the GT value needed for effective flocculation is between 10 raised to 4 to 10 raised to 5. Okay, this is what is commonly used. And the time usually provided in flocculation systems are varying from 10 to 30 minutes. So once you decide the G value, okay, and you know what is the total GT you need, we can find out what is the T we have to provide, and that will decide the tank size. Okay, and this is very important. Large G values with short T will give you small and dense flocks. Low G value with long T gives you larger and light flock. But what we need is okay larger and dense flock. So for that one, most of the time in the flocculation unit, what we do is initially you give large G value, and as we enter towards the end of the tank, reduce the G value. So you will be getting large dense flocks. Okay, so it will be much easier to remove the particles, okay, if they are large and dense. Okay, so this is a typical okay flocculator. Okay, you can see that chemical addition, and here the mixing is happening. So how to design a flocculator? Calculation of G value. Okay, here P is power input, that is equal to D into VP. What is this D? D is the crack force on paddles. The paddles you are seeing, these are the paddles. Okay, you can see that these are the paddles. So and VP is the velocity of paddle in meter per second. So track force on paddle, we can use this formula to calculate CD AP rho W into VP squared whole divided by 2. This is the track force on the paddle, where CD is the dimensionless coefficient of track, around 1.8 for flat blades. AP is the area of paddle blades, okay, perpendicular to the water surface, and rho is the density of water, and VP is the velocity of the paddle. Okay, once we get the track force power input, we can calculate using the formula D into VP. So P is equal to CD AP rho VP cube by 2, and G we have seen, G is equal to P by V mu raised to half. So G will be equal to C. We can substitute this one here, you will be getting 2 V mu. And AP, if you have many paddles, combined area of slots that are perpendicular to the cylinder of rotation. Okay, so if your paddles are rotating like this, the perpendicular to the cylinder of rotation, so Okay, that this will be the partial area coming into picture. So when we design a flocculator, the points to be remembered are AP should not be greater than 40% of the total partial area. VP is equal to, that means partial velocity of the tip of the partial velocity is 75% of the partial speed. Okay, this is relative velocity with respect to water, and VP is okay should be less than 1 meter per second. Minimum clearance of 0.3 meter with the partial tip and other structures should be provided. Avoid turbulence from flocculating basin to settling basin. Okay, this is very important. Okay, to prevent breakage of flocks. Once the flocks are formed, okay, avoid turbulence. If you have turbulence, then the formed flocks will be okay break. Okay, broken, and the settling will be getting affected. Okay, so this is the important point to be removed. Initially high G value with low T followed by low G value with high T. Variation of G value from inlet to outlet around 100% or a factor of 2 is advisable to get large and dense flocks. Okay, so the flocculation okay can be happening with perikinetic or orthokinetic. Perikinetic is even if you are not having any mechanical mixture or anything, because of the thermal motion or Brownian motion, some amount of flocculation will be happening. Another one is mechanical thing, we call it as orthokinetic flocculation. So now we'll see the factors influencing coagulation and flocculation. Okay, the factors influencing are coagulant dosage, we have discussed in details. Then characteristics of water, this also we have seen. Alkalinity plays a significant role in coagulation. Then optimum pH zone, because your metal hydroxide will be forming, okay, at a the optimum formation will be happening at a particular pH. So optimum pH zone is important, and sometimes coagulant aid also can improve the coagulation. Clay, fullers, earth, bentonites, activated carbon used for nuclei formation. So this one we have already discussed. So choice of coagulant, you can go for either alum or copperas, that is ferrosulfate, or you can go for ferric chloride, you can go for chlorinated copperas or natural polymers like lady fingers and other things. Okay, all these things are possible, okay, to be used as coagulants. And okay, this table is there, this PPT will be shared to you. Okay, detention time and velocity gradient and power input for different okay design. Okay, I have given here, and it's not that always we have to go for mechanical flocculators. Okay, if you can provide a velocity gradient in the system, non-mechanical flocculators also can be used. This is an example of a non-mechanical flocculator, a baffled wall tank. So here what is happening, the water enters here, it passes through like this. So because of this one, lot of head loss will be okay happening, and there will be a turbulence, and as a result the particles will be agglomerating together. Okay, so there are many other devices okay which can act as non-mechanical flocculators, and this is an example of mechanical flocculator. These are the paddles, okay, it will be rotating in this direction, okay, and the flocculation will be happening. Okay, so that is about coagulation and flocculation. So coagulation, flocculation and sedimentation, so most of your colloidal particles will be getting removed. But we know that none of the processes will be having 100% efficiency. So you will be having some flocks, okay, which is not able to settle because it may be very small, or the broken flocks that may be there. So we have to remove those things also from water to get a okay good quality water which is free from turbidity, etc. So we use filtration as a polishing step to remove small flocks or precipitant particles not removed in the settling of coagulated or softened water. So filtration act as a polishing step, okay, and filtration, okay, sometimes we go for direct filtration instead of going for coagulation and flocculation, etc. So the main aim is turbidity removal, and filtration removes pathogens also, but not a complete treatment unit for bacteriological safety. We may get 99% removal, etc., but for drinking water the pathogens should be free. So filtration alone will not be able to remove all the pathogens present in the water. Most commonly used filter is granular medium filter, and diatomaceous earth, okay, is also used in swimming pools and industrial applications. Then pre-cut filters and porous media filters, etc., are also being used. Okay, now we'll see what are the different types of filters. We can have classify them into two categories: surface filters and depth filters. Surface filters, depth is not important, material is removed in the surface. For example, you can take any screens or strainers or micro strainers, cloth filters, vacuum filters or membrane units. Okay, all these things are coming under surface filters. That means the straining is happening in the surface layer, so the depth of the filter is not at all important. The second one is depth filter. Here depth is very important. An example is gravity filter. Okay, that means entire depth of the filter is being used for cleaning the water. So filters are classified into two categories: surface filter and depth filter. So now we see the most commonly used filters for water treatment. One is slow sand filter and another one is rapid sand filter. So as the name represents, slow sand sand filter means the filtration rate is very very slow, and it is the simplest filter without any mechanical or mechanical equipment. And here what we are doing, you get a truckload of sand, put it in a tank with a under drainage system, and the water is allowed to filter through the sand filter. And here the major mechanism of removal is straining. This is very important. Rapid sand filter and slow sand filter, don't think that only difference is the rate of filtration. There are many other differences. Okay, in slow sand filter the mechanism of removal is straining, and in the top layer you will be getting some biological layer. Okay, that means it is exposed to sunlight and all the things, so a biological layer will be formed, and it is also known as dirty layer. So if you see the slow sand filter, the removal of pollutants, the turbid particles and others will be occurring in the top 2 inch. Okay, top 2 inch depth. So and the filtration rate is only 130 to 150 liters per meter squared per hour. So how can we clean the slow sand filter? After some time the filter will be getting choked, so we have to clean the filter. So in case of slow sand filter, since all the removal is taking place only in the top 2 inch portion, cleaning is by scraping the top layer. Okay, so if you scrap the 2 inch, then remaining sand will be clean, and again the filtration will be happening without any problem. And as the sand depth comes down, we have to add more sand to keep the level. Okay, so this is very important. Slow sand filter, rate of filtration is small, the mechanism of removal is straining, and there is a biological layer. So this biological layer will be responsible for removing any soluble organic matter, or sometimes even the removal of nitrogen, etc., present in the system. And all the removals will be taking place mostly in the top 2 inch portion. So cleaning of the filter is by scraping the top layer. This is very important. Now coming to the rapid sand filter, as I told, the sand rapid means fast. So filtration rate is very high. Okay, 4000 to 6000 liters per meter square per hour. Earlier was 130 to 150 liters per. Okay, you can see that it is much faster filtration. And this is the filter most commonly used in water treatment plants. And we use coarser media, around 0.4 to 0.6 mm diameter particles, and uniformity coefficient of the sand is around 1.3 to 1.7. Okay, so this is the rapid sand filter. You cannot just bring a truckload and put it. You have to sieve it and remove the two fine sand, two coarse sand, and only the sand with a particle size of 0.4 to 0.6 and a uniformity coefficient of 1.3 to 1.7 is being used for rapid sand filter. And see, here the removal is taking place in the throughout the depth of the filter. Okay, earlier case it was only the straining the top, but in rapid sand filter entire depth of the filter will be used for cleaning the water. So once the filter is clogged, by scraping the filter cannot be clean, so we have to go for backwashing. So backwashing is done only for rapid sand filter, not for slow sand filter. And this backwashing is done when the head loss reaches around 1.2 meter to 2.5 meter. And most commonly used filter media are sand, coal, anthracite, coconut shell, ballastic stone dust, etc. Hope you got some idea. And this is the rapid sand filter arrangement. You can see that this is the filter chamber. You have the under drainage system here. You can see the pores. Okay. And this is the pipe connecting the thing. And this is, okay, you will have the gravel, okay, around 40 to 60 centimeter. And above that one, you have the sand layer. That is around 60 to 76 centimeter. Then this is the freeboard. Here you can see the water trough, and you will be having a wash water or backwash tank here. So during filtration, what happens? Okay, the water that influent water to be treated comes here. It gets filled up to here. You can see that, and this much of head is available, around 60 plus 76. Okay, around 130, 1.36 meters of water head is available. This is the one which is driving the filtration. So this water will be getting filtered through this one, and it comes out, and okay, so you can get the treated water through this one, effluent. You can see that all these places you have lot of valves. Okay, by opening the valves, okay, first open this A valve, water will be entering, it will be filtered, and you can collect through B. So once the filter is, okay, filter head loss increased to 2.5 meter, we have to backwash the filter. So how are we going to do the backwash? So for that one only, this overhead tank, this water is stored at the higher head. So you open this D valve. So here during backwash, the flow direction is getting reversed. That means this water will be entering through this one. So entire this, okay, gravel and sand will be getting fluidized, and whatever the turbid particles attached to that one will be, okay, dislodging, and the dirty water will be, okay, coming through this, okay, wash water trough, and get here, and we can drain it off like this. Okay, clear? Okay, we open this valve, all the water will be entering through this one, all this sand will be getting fluidized and getting washed, and the dirty water comes here, flows through this one, and this is going to the drainage system. Okay, and after the backwash, what we'll do? We clean, okay, again, okay, start the filtration. But initially, you will be having some turbid particles. So, the treated water we drained off. Once the water become clean, again you collect the effluent. So, this is the functioning of a rapid sand filter. Okay, by controlling the valves, we will be able to do the filtration as well as backwashing. Nothing else is there. Sometimes for the backwashing, we add air bubbles also, so that the agitation will be much more efficient. And another type of filter is dual media or multimedia filter. Here, okay, we go for combination of two media, okay, with density differences. Coarser and lighter media at top, heavier and fine one at the bottom. Okay, so this one will be improving the filtration efficiency. Okay, and another thing is activated carbon filters and pressure filters. These are being used in industries as well as in swimming pools and all. It's a closed system, more head loss permitted, groundwater purification, ferric and manganese removal, and small installation and swimming pools, we go for, okay, pressure filters, etc. Okay, and what are the transport mechanism affecting the, okay, filtration, viscosity of the water, filtration rate, size of the media, size and density of the particles. Okay, whatever we have seen in coagulation and flocculation, same mechanisms are applicable here also in filtration. So how the filter, okay, in rapid sand filter, the materials are getting removed. One is mechanical straining. So this is the filter media. Okay, you can see that filter media. So in between, when the water flows, the particles will be getting, okay, strained between this filter materials. You can see that this blue and red particles are sitting. This green ones are the filter media. Okay, so one is mechanical straining. Second one is gravitational settling. So what is happening? Imagine here some particle enters, and all this is acting as a sedimentation tank. So the particles can settle and stay on the filter media. So that is the second mechanism. Third mechanism is interception. This is the filter media, and this is the streamlines. You see, the water flows like this. So along with the particles, along with the water, the colloidal particles are also coming, and the distance between the colloidal particles and the streamline, if it is colloidal particle and the filter media is less, then what will happen? The colloidal particles will be getting attached to the filter media, that is interception. Third one is impaction. Here, this is the way the water moves, streamline. The colloidal particles, okay, will be having some inertia. So instead of following this streamline, it may travel straight. As a result, it can come and hit the filter media. So once it hit the filter media, it is getting removed. And the last one is Brownian motion, because colloidal particles are very very small particles, they undergo Brownian motion, or Brownian motion is significant. As a result, okay, you can see that it will be moving like that, and the particles can come and get attached to the filter media. So these are the mechanisms that is responsible for colloidal particle removal in rapid sand filter. Okay, and once the particles comes in contact with the filter media, the attachment step is similar to flocculation. You have the van der Waals force of attraction, okay, mutual adsorption or bridging, etc. So this is the reason why we tell, even if you go for direct filtration, it is better to add little bit of alum, so that your colloidal particles will be destabilized, then the filtration will be more effective. So this is what happens during the filtration. So this is the, if you see the head, this one, okay, pressure, okay, pressure in a filter, and this is the water surface, this is the bottom of the filter. The pressure distribution will be something similar to this. Okay, you can see this straight line, a static pressure without any flow. If some flow is there, some head loss will be there, so you'll be having a, okay, a pressure like this. Okay, this first line we can see without flow. This is the static pressure head, and this is the clean filter at this end rate. Okay, this will be the pressure. So as the filtration increases, what will happen? The head loss in the filter increases. So you'll be, okay, having the pressure head like this. And after some time, if you are not taking care of the thing, okay, you'll be getting a negative head. Okay, so once this is formed, the filter performance will not be good at all. So we have to go for backwashing. So that's the reason why we tell, when the head loss is in the range of 1.3 to 2.5, you have to go for backwashing. Okay, negative head, head loss exceeds total depth of water, causes air pockets, and okay, filter cracks, okay, and head loss increases, and this one will be deteriorating the effluent quality. So don't allow the filter to, okay, reach the negative head. Before that one, you have to go for, okay, backwashing. So how are you going to do the backwashing? Okay, it is, okay, the principle is hydraulic flow through porous media. We are using Darcy's equation for finding out the head loss and backwash velocity. So the head loss can be find out in a filter using this equation. HF is equal to F into L into 1 minus E into V squared divided by E cube into G into dp. HF is the head loss through bed of particles of uniform size. Okay, the diameter of the particle is dp, and L is the length of the filter, F is the friction coefficient, E is the porosity of the bed, and Vs is the filtering velocity, the velocity of the water just above the bed, total, okay, flow Q to the filter divided by area of the filter, that is the filtration velocity. Q divided by cross sectional area of the filter, that will give you Vs. E is the porosity of the bed, L is the length of the filter media, if it is 75 cm or 1.5 meter. DP is a particle diameter, okay, in the filter media. Okay, G is acceleration due to gravity. So using this formula, we will be able to find out the head loss at any point. Okay, and okay, and F dash you can calculate using the this formula. F dash is equal to 150 into 1 minus epsilon divided by RE plus 1.75. RE is the Reynolds number. You know how to calculate the Reynolds number. Rho Vd by mu and the shape factor. Okay, so F is a friction factor, is a function of Reynolds number. So you have to find out F using this formula. So if you have non-uniform media, multimedia and all, okay, etc., head loss is equal to L into 1 minus E V squared by E cube into G. Okay, this D you have to take the, okay, each layer D Fij into Xij by Dij. Xij is the weight fraction between adjacent sieve sizes. So we take each diameter and each layer and calculate the sum of the head losses. Okay, in mixed media filter, I told you ideal filter because medium graded evenly. So if you have a depth filter, if you have the coarse material in the top and fine material in the bottom, the filter will be maximum efficient. But if you use sand and put the coarse material in the top and fine material in the bottom, next backwashing, what will happen? The fine material will go in the top and coarse material will come in the back. So again the filter will be, okay, in the opposite direction graded. So that is not effective. So what we have to do is you have to select different materials, okay, based upon the density, so that the coarse material even during the backwash it will be always in the top. So you take lighter material in and lighter and coarser in the top, medium size in the middle and smaller and dense particles in the bottom, then you will be getting a very good filter because the pore size distribution will be like this. That means maximum pore size in the top and minimum in the bottom, so that entire filter depth can be effectively used. Okay, so multimedia filter, okay, an example is 60% anthracite, then silica and garnet sand. Okay, these missing here. You can see anthracite, the density is, or specific gravity is 1.6 and DP is 1 millimeter. Here specific gravity is 2.6 and garnet sand specific gravity is 4.2. So the lightest one in the top and then the medium, then the smallest. So here what is happening, this type of a thing, the pore size distribution, ideal case is something like this. Okay, the maximum pore size in the top, as the depth increases the pore size will decrease. So in multimedia mixed media filter, somewhat that pattern you will be getting. Each layer there will be a difference, but more or less you will be getting high pore size in the top, so that entire filter media can be used effectively. Okay, so this is, okay, what is the normally used filter sand. Okay, its properties: hard and resistant, effective size 0.45 to 0.7. I already told uniformity coefficient 1.3 to 1.7. Ignition loss should be less than 0.7%. Soluble fraction in HCl should be less than 5%. Silica content should be greater than 90%. Specific gravity 2.5 to 2.65. Wearing loss should be less than 3%. This is the properties for a good filter sand. And depth of the sand, okay, varies from 0.6 to 0.75 centimeters in a rapid sand filter, and standing water depth is 1 to 2 meter. Freeboard always give 0.5 meter. Okay, and then backwashing, when head loss reaches a limit, we have to go for backwashing. Okay, if you won't go for backwashing, effluent quality become unacceptable. So backwashing is very very essential. So again, fluidized bed, okay, theory we are using for backwash. So get loss, head loss between the bottom and top of any layer of thickness is equal to weight of suspended material in water. So if you want to fluidize the material, okay, so the head loss will be equal to the weight of suspended material in water. This is the equation we use for calculating the backwash velocity. So head loss HF into rho L into G, that is equal to, L is the length of the filter media, rho S minus rho L or rho W into G into 1 minus eta gives you the weight of suspended material in water, because it is not only the gravity force, it is the drag and gravity force in equilibrium when the particles are in suspension. So that is what we are taking. So from this equation you will be getting HF by L is equal to rho S minus rho L divided by rho L into 1 minus E. This rho L is nothing but rho W, density of water. Okay, and this is, okay, fluidized bed. Okay, how we are calculating? So L is the length of the, okay, when we do the backwashing, if you have L length, the length will be expanding because the sand particles will not be, okay, sitting on one another. It will be in a fluidized state. So how can we find out the porosity of the fluidized bed. Okay, so you can use this one. Mass balance we are taking L into 1 minus E. Okay, this is the total volume of sand. Rho S minus rho W into rho W into G. Okay, this is the weight. That is equal to LFB. This is the fluidized bed length into 1 minus E into FB. EFB. Okay, this is the porosity of the expanded bed into rho S minus rho W by rho W into G. So, length of fluidized bed is equal to L into 1 minus E by 1 minus EFB. That means the mass of sand is not getting changed. Only thing changing is the porosity. Based upon the porosity, your L will be increasing. This is the length of fluidized bed. And what is this porosity of the fluidized bed? It is depending upon backwash velocity divided by settling velocity of the sand particle raised to 0.22. So, you can decide what is the expansion, porosity expansion you want. Based upon that one, you can find out what is the backwash velocity. Or for a given backwash velocity, you can find out what is the porosity of the expanded bed. Okay. So, the bed should be properly expanded so that all the colloidal particles, whatever is got attached to the thing, will be getting removed. Okay. Thank you. So, this is all about coagulation and filtration. So, we'll have some interaction for 10 minutes. Then I'll start the next module. Okay. Do you have any doubts? Okay. Whatever we have discussed until now, because I am going to change to some other topic. Yeah. One question is, why alum is more used in water treatment as a coagulant? Because, if you use iron as a coagulant, iron will be giving some sort of a color. So, that is the major reason why we are using alum as a coagulant. If you see the settling property of the flock, ferric hydroxide flocks are settling better. But because of the color and residual concentration, we always prefer alum in water treatment. All of you understood what are the mechanisms of coagulation and filtration? Any natural coagulants for wastewater? See, natural coagulants in wastewater treatment, the best natural coagulant is the extra polymers excreted by the microorganism, because you can see the secondary sedimentation tank, all the microorganisms are forming the flow. Because actually the size of microorganisms are 1 micrometer or 10 micrometer, 1 to 10 micrometer, but those microorganisms are settling very fast in the secondary sedimentation tank. There the flocculation is happening. It is because of the extracellular polymers excreted by the microorganisms. In water treatment, people use nirmali seeds, moringa seeds, lady finger, etc. as natural coagulants. Only thing is, they will be acting as natural coagulants, but the treated water cannot be stored for long period, because lot of organic matter will be excreted or leaching out from these materials, and it will be there in the water. So, if you store the water treated with this natural coagulants, the chances of bacterial growth will be more. So, you can use it and you can treat it and use it immediately, but don't store it for long period. Any other question? How to use the flock? We are not using the flocks. We are creating conducive environment for the formation of flock so that the particles will be settling down. The flock means agglomeration of the particles. So our objective is to make flocks. And flocks are used. Once the flocks are formed, the size is increasing. And last class we have seen is in the settling velocity is directly proportional to square of the diameter. So more the diameter, higher the settling velocity. So, the time required for settling will be decreasing drastically, and that will reduce the size of the sedimentation tank. So, that's the reason why we are going for the flocculation. So, this module I'll be discussing about disinfection, then iron, manganese and fluoride removal. Whatever we can cover today, we'll cover disinfection. All of you know what is disinfection. Here, disinfection is the process in which pathogens are destroyed or inactivated. And what is the difference between disinfection and sterilization? In disinfection, only pathogens are destroyed or inactivated. In sterilization, all the microorganisms, either they are pathogens or non-pathogens, all the microorganisms are killed in disinfection. No, in sterilization. So please understand the difference between disinfection and sterilization. So now we will see what are the different methods which can be used for disinfection. One is physicochemical treatment. Second one is direct application of thermal energy. Third one is ultraviolet rays, X-rays, gamma rays and microwave radiation. Okay, all these things can kill the pathogens. Then ultrasonic disruption, okay, addition of chemical agents. The last one is the most commonly used disinfection method. So, we will see one by one in little detail. Okay, so before going into the disinfectant, we will see what are the properties of a good disinfectant. This is very important because you have so much of choice. So, you have to select the best one. So, it should kill all the pathogens and it should be effective in a wide range of pH and mineral compositions, because you know that the water quality will be changing from place to place and the pH also can vary significantly. So, the disinfectant whatever you are choosing should be effective in a wide range of pH and mineral composition. And the third one is the disinfectant should not produce any toxic byproducts, because by adding the disinfectant you are killing the pathogens, but the disinfectant should not be toxic, or disinfectant should not produce any toxic byproducts. And the last one is the disinfectant should have some residual effect. Why? Because we are disinfecting the water in the treatment plant and after that one we are sending the water through pipeline kilometers together. So if some leakage or something happened, or after the treatment some contamination happened, the water should be safe at the point of use. So to make sure that we always keep some residual effect. So your disinfectant should have this residual effect. Okay, these are the good properties of a good disinfectant. So now we will see how the disinfection is happening. Okay, because it is pathogens, we have to destruct the pathogens. So some of the disinfectants damage the cell wall. Some disinfectants alter the membrane permeability, then changing the colloidal nature of the protoplasm, inactivation of critical enzymes, and sometimes they may alter the DNA structure. So one or two or all the mechanisms can happen with various disinfectants. So these are the mechanisms of disinfection: damage to cell wall, alteration of membrane permeability, changing the colloidal nature of the protoplasm, inactivation of critical enzymes, or altering the DNA structure. So first we'll see chemical disinfectant, because this is the most commonly used disinfectants. So the most commonly used chemical disinfectants are halogens, either chlorine, bromine or iodine. All of them are having disinfecting characteristics because they all are strong oxidizing agents. And another chemical commonly used is ozone. It is a very good disinfectant, but it is expensive compared to halogens, and ozone can destroy color and odor effectively. And another disinfectant we use is potassium permanganate, KMnO4, or hydrogen peroxide or H2O2. Then sometimes we use metal ions also. For example, silver is a bactericidal and copper is a algicidal. Earlier days our grandparents or forefathers used to keep the water in copper containers and all, because they were aware that these containers were having disinfecting properties. The other chemicals we use for disinfection is acids and alkali. If the pH is less than 3 or greater than 11, many of the microorganisms will not be able to survive. So that is the way we kill the pathogens, by using acids and alkali. Now we will see what are the factors affecting the chemical disinfection. The most important thing is the type of organism. The nature, concentration and distribution of organisms are very, very important. For example, if you have cyst forming microorganism, the disinfection may not be very effective, because the disinfectant should penetrate into the cyst and enter into the cell membrane. Okay, so that's why the type of organism is very important, which affect the disinfection capability. Then the disinfectant itself, the nature, concentration and distribution of the disinfectant. Temperature plays a significant role because it is chemical most of the chemical reactions are temperature dependent. So temperature also plays a significant role. The next one is time of contact. How much time the microorganisms are coming in contact with the disinfectant? The last one is the rate and condition by which water is disinfected. How, if the water is very clean, the disinfection is much more effective compared to tepid water and all. So we'll see this one in detail. So first is rate of disinfection. Okay, this is a very famous law, Chick's law. It says, okay, the rate of disinfection, that means dN by dt. N is the number of pathogens present initially. So rate of change of pathogen number with respect to time. Okay, that is why dN by dt. The negative sign is coming because the number is decreasing with respect to time. That is equal to a constant into number of pathogens present initially. Okay, the rate of destruction is proportional to the number of pathogens present initially, or the rate of disinfection or destruction is equal to a constant into number of pathogens present. So if you integrate this one, you will be getting ln n by n naught is equal to minus kt, or the number of pathogen at any time can be calculated using this formula, n is equal to n naught into e raised to minus kt. N is the number of organism and n naught is the number of organism present when t is equal to 0, and k is the rate of disinfection. Okay, and this k will be depending upon the characteristics of the organism as well as the disinfectant. Okay, and disinfectant concentration is also important. Here we are not taking into account the disinfectant concentration. So here we can show that C raised to n into t is a constant. If n is equal to 1, concentration and time are important. If n less than 1, concentration is less important compared to time. So we can find out whether disinfection concentration or contact time, which plays a significant role. Then temperature, here we use Mannhoff's equation. The rate of reaction changes with respect to temperature. So that is what is happening here. So the rate of destruction, K2 is at temperature T2, can be calculated using this formula. Ln K2 by K1 is equal to ln T1 by T2 equal to E into T2 minus T1 by R into T2 T1. Okay, this is the universal gas constant and all. Okay, and the most commonly used disinfection in India is chlorine. So we will see what is happening during chlorine disinfection. You see here, when chlorine is added to water, chlorine is reacting with water to give HOCl and HCl. So one chlorine molecule react with one molecule of water gives you one molecule of HOCl and one molecule of HCl. So if the water doesn't have alkalinity, when you add chlorine, the pH of the water will be reducing because of the acid production. And this HOCl can be dissociated into H++ OCl minus. Okay, and in any system, HOCl and OCl together are known as free chlorine, and the availability of HOCl and OCl are pH dependent, because if you have low pH, you will be having more HOCl, and if your pH in the system is high, you will be having more OCl minus. Okay, so this gives the dissociation constant. Okay, this is HOCl plus the dissociation constant, and you can see that at a given pH, what will be the OCl concentration and HOCl concentration using this formula. And this is very important. In water sources and wastewater sources, lot of ammonia will be present. If ammonia is present in the water, chlorine will be reacting with ammonia to form chloramines. You have monochloramine, dichloramine, trichloramine, and after this one, this will be dissociating and nitrogen will be escaping from the system. So this can be used to remove ammonia from the water also. This chlorine also will be having this chlorine. This chloramines are also known as combined chlorine. Monochloramine, dichloramine, trichloramine, they are known as combined chlorine. They are also having disinfectant properties. So many times these chloramines are used as residual disinfectant. So this is the breakthrough curve, breakpoint chlorination for breakpoint chlorination. So here what we are doing is, you have a water sample or a wastewater sample, you are taking, we are chlorinating that water, and with respect to time we are measuring the chlorine residuals. Okay, when we add chlorine, some amount of chlorine will be used up by the microorganisms, organic matter, and reduced inorganics present in the water, and remaining chlorine will be present in the water. So you, here you see x-axis shows what is the total chlorine dose you are adding, and y-axis shows chlorine residuals present in the water. So initially you can see that though you are adding chlorine, residual chlorine is almost zero. So what is happening here, most of the chlorine is utilized by the compounds present in the water which are in the reduced form. For example, Fe2+, sulfide, etc., if they are present in the water, they will be using the chlorine to get oxidized. So that's why we are not seeing any residual chlorine here. And even if organic matter are present, that also will be using chlorine to get oxidized. And after this, what happened? The chlorine will be combining with ammonia present in the system. So as the chlorine dose increases, your residual chlorine is increasing. This is in the form of monochloramine, dichloramine, trichloramine, etc. By the time, all the ammonia will be getting converted to trichloramine. And if you still further increase the chlorine dosage, trichloramine will be dissociating and ammonia gas will be, nitrogen gas will be escaping and chloride ions will be present in the system. So you can see a sudden dip in the residual chlorine. That means your combined chlorine is, combined chlorine in the form of trichloramine. Trichloramine is dissociated and nitrogen gas is escaped from the system. So you can see the dip, and this point C is known as the break point. That means your all the organic matter and ammonia is removed from the system. And after that one, if you add chlorine, all the chlorine added will be remaining as free residual chlorine. And here you can see little bit, the combined residual chlorine will be present. So this is the residual, from this point onwards, whatever you are adding, that will be remaining as free residual chlorine. And this breakpoint chlorination, this experiment is very important to find out the chlorine dosage for either wastewater treatment or water treatment. So when we talk about chlorination, different ways we can do the chlorination. One is plain chlorination. This is surface water with no other treatment. That means you know that the water is very safe. For example, your groundwater sources which may be contaminated with pathogens. So you know that there is no turbidity and other contaminant, but you wanted to be sure that the water is safe for drinking. So in such cases you can go for plain chlorination, or when you are sure that your water is having high organic content, then you can go for plain chlorination, but high chlorine dose is needed. And when you go for plain chlorination, you see the combined available chlorine should be around 0.5 milligram per liter, and plain chlorination is advisable when the turbidity is less than 5 and iron and manganese concentration is less than 0.3 milligram per liter, and plain chlorination is used for relatively unpolluted water sources. Now the second one is pre-chlorination. Pre-chlorination means chlorination is done before other treatment. This is having many advantages, because you know that if your water source is some lake or something like that, the water will be having lot of algal cells and all. So if you do the pre-chlorination, it will improve the coagulation. So many places it has shown that pre-chlorination will improve the coagulation, and this one will reduce the taste and odor, because taste and odor are caused by dissolved organic matter. So chlorine will be oxidizing the dissolved organic matter, so the taste and odor will be reducing. When we do the pre-chlorination, algae and other microorganisms will be getting destructed. So this one will help to keep the filter clean when you are doing the filtration. And the effectiveness depends upon the residual chlorine concentration. Preferred residual chlorine concentration varies from 0.1 to 0.5 milligram per liter. So pre-chlorination before the treatment, we have seen plain chlorination, pre-chlorination, post-chlorination. This is the general practice. addition of chlorine after other treatments. Okay, you have to provide a minimum contact time of 30 minutes if when we go for the chlorination. Okay, and I told you chlorine is the most commonly used disinfectant in India. So if you see what are the different points of okay, different sources of chlorine or different forms of chlorine we are using for disinfection. One is bleaching powder. Okay, this has around 20 to 30% of available chlorine. Another one is hypochlorite, around 60 to 70% of available chlorine. Then chlorine dioxide we can use. Okay, and this is efficient in the pH range of 6 to 10. And what are the disadvantages of chlorination? Okay, the problem is disinfection byproducts, formation of chlorophenols. This can create taste and odor. And formation of organochlorine compounds, most of them are carcinogenic in nature. So disinfection byproducts, okay, what are these disinfection byproducts? Okay, disinfection byproducts are okay formed due to the reaction between organic and inorganic, okay, inorganic compounds present in water with chemical disinfectants. So because this chlorine, bromine, iodine, any of the halogens or ozone or anything you take, they are strong oxidizing agents. So they have a tendency to react with other organic and inorganic compounds present in the water. So as a result, okay, some byproducts are generated. They are known as disinfection byproducts. And they are an integral part of drinking water supply system. And they were first detected in 1970s. More than 500 disinfection byproducts have been detected. Okay, this one gives okay, what are the different types of disinfection byproducts? Organic disinfection byproduct precursor. That means if the water, when before disinfection, if they have natural organic matter, algal organic matter, wastewater, effluent organic matter, any of these things are there, you get okay, disinfection byproducts. Okay, and some inorganic compounds like bromide, iodide, and nitrate also cause the generation of disinfection byproducts, and chlorine, chloramines, chlorine dioxide and ozone. Okay, these are the disinfectants you can create. Okay, and okay, that means either organic precursors or inorganic precursors with disinfectants can generate disinfection byproducts. So what are the emerging disinfection byproducts? It can be trihalomethanes, haloacetic acids, haloacetaldehyde, halonitromethanes, nitrosamines. All these are examples of disinfection byproducts. So hope it is clear. If you have natural organic matter or inorganic compounds, when they are present in the water to be disinfected, when we add the disinfectant, all these compounds can be formed. Okay, and the DBP's formation depends on pH, temperature, nature and okay, nature of organic okay, non-biodegradable organic matter and inorganic matter present in raw and treated water, contact time between water, disinfectant and biological degradation of some compounds, type and dose of disinfectant. All these parameters, whatever we have seen, the factors affecting disinfection, same things are playing a role in the disinfection byproduct formation also. Okay, so we will see what are the disinfection byproducts during chlorination. Chlorine disinfection byproducts are the most studied and regulated disinfection byproducts. Trihalomethanes and haloacetic acids are the most prevalent and documented disinfection byproducts when we do the chlorination. Okay, and trihalomethanes, chloroform, bromodichloromethane, dibromochloromethane and bromoforms are also reported. This is haloacetic acids, monochloroacetic acid, dichloroacetic acid, trichloroacetic acid, mono and dibromoacetic acid. Okay, these things are also reported in many water distribution systems. And why are we so much bothered about disinfection byproducts? This can cause cancer. Okay, either bladder, colon, rectal, and both in humans and animals, lot of study results are there. And chloride causes anemia, okay, and may cause damage to human reproduction and development also. So this disinfection byproducts are bad. It has very bad side effects. But if you inject pathogens, okay, the effect will be immediate. So we go for disinfection by these compounds because they are much inexpensive and can be adopted by anybody. Not much technical knowledge is needed. So how can we analyze and monitor? Normal water quality analysis, we won't analyze the disinfection byproducts. It needs highly sophisticated instrumentation like GC, gas chromatography, gas chromatography, mass spectroscopy, etc. So in normal cases, we won't monitor the disinfection byproduct. And if disinfection byproducts are present in the system, how can we remove them? If you provide an adsorption system or membrane process, then many of these disinfection byproducts can be removed from the treated water. So that is about disinfection. Now we'll see how to remove iron and manganese. You may be thinking, why are we discussing about iron and manganese? But as we have seen in the first lecture, iron and manganese are commonly present in groundwater. So before going to iron and manganese, I wanted to add here something. Ozone is very commonly used disinfectant, and ozone is very, very good disinfectant, but it is costlier than chlorine, and ozone also creates disinfection byproducts, but it is lower than chlorine. Then another commonly used disinfection system is UV, but the mechanisms and all are different. So most of the time in India, in water treatment systems, we use chlorine as the disinfection, disinfectant. So now coming back to iron and manganese, as I told you earlier, iron and manganese are naturally found in groundwater. They do not cause adverse health effect at concentrations typically found in groundwater. Aesthetic importance, if iron is present, it forms rust, stain the clothes, discolor pumping fixtures, etc. And the standard, USEPA standard for iron is 0.3 milligram per liter or 0.3 ppm, and for manganese it is 0.05 milligram per liter. Bureau of Indian Standard, also iron is 0.3 ppm and manganese is 0.1 ppm. This is the permissible level. When soluble iron and manganese comes in contact to oxidizing environment, so for example, the groundwater, iron will be present in the form of Fe2+, that means ferrous, and manganese will be present in the form of Mn2+. So when the groundwater is pumped and come to the tap water, when the tap is opened, the water is coming in contact with the air. So this iron and manganese will get oxidized to Fe3+ and Mn4+. So this Fe3+ will form ferric hydroxide with a reddish brown color, and manganese oxide precipitate gives a black color. So if iron and manganese present in the water, if you collect the water in glasses or beakers or whatever thing, when it get exposed to air, it will be showing reddish color or blackish color. So definitely it is not aesthetically pleasing. So we have to remove these compounds from water. So what are the different methods for iron and manganese removal? One is water softening, using ion exchange, we will be able to remove iron and manganese. Then polyphosphate addition can be used for iron removal. Oxidation followed by filtration, this is the most commonly used method for iron and manganese removal. Other treatment methods such as aeration, ozonation, and catalytic carbon. Here also what we are doing is, we are using different methods to oxidize Fe2+ and Mn2+ to Fe3+ and Mn4+. Then precipitate it, and the precipitate you filter it out using different media. So that is the most commonly used method for iron and manganese removal. So we will see one by one in detail. Water softening, here exchanging Fe and Mn with sodium on a resin bed. Ion exchange means some ion is exchanged for iron, other ion. So here sodium, a cationic exchange resin, sodium ion is exchanged with Fe and Mn. Removal efficiency depending upon the Fe concentration, water hardness, and pH. Oxidized Fe and Mn are avoided to fouled resins, because if this Fe and Mn, whatever is there in the ion exchange, if it is getting oxidized, then the precipitation will be happening and your ion exchange will be getting fouled. So it is better to avoid that one. So recommended pH is greater than 6.7. Water hardness should be 50 to 350 milligram per liter. Fe concentration should be less than 5 milligram per liter if you want to go for ion exchange process. The next method is polyphosphate addition. Here, this is suitable when Fe concentration less than 2 milligram per liter. Generally ineffective for manganese. This polyphosphate addition is okay, can be used only for iron removal. Actually, Fe is sequestered by phosphates and it is not actually removed from the water. Okay, so if you add polyphosphate, the problems of metallic taste, excessive phosphate in water, it may cause metallic taste, and more phosphate in the water may cause diarrhea also. So this is not a very commonly used method for iron and manganese removal. Oxidation followed by filtration, this is the most commonly used method for iron and manganese removal. Okay, so, and it is more effective when iron and manganese concentrations are relatively high. Okay, here what we are doing, conversion of dissolved Fe2 plus and Mn2 plus to solid Fe3 plus and Mn4 plus. So Fe2 plus and Mn2 plus, we are oxidizing and getting, okay, it converted to Fe3 plus and Mn4 plus. Okay, and this one, okay, the oxidation and all depends upon the pH, EH and temperature of water. So that one will be, okay, telling you how effective the oxidation will be. And apart from air, you can use chlorine, potassium permanganate, H2O2, etc. Okay, for the oxidation of Fe2 plus and Mn2 plus. Okay, once you oxidize this one, it is advisable to use activated carbon filter as a post-treatment. You need to avoid taste and odor of chlorine. High manganese concentration, okay, chlorine is not advisable as it requires high pH to complete the oxidation, because you know that when chlorine is added, the pH will be coming down. So if you have high manganese concentration, okay, very high pH is needed for the oxidation. So many times we may not be going for chlorine oxidation. Other treatment methods, okay, aeration, cascading, bubbling, or stripping the gas from the water. So many times, okay, if your source of water is lake water, we have this cascade system in the beginning of the water treatment unit. So the water will be, okay, pumped up and it will be flowing in a stepwise manner. That means the cascading action. So the water will be coming in contact with the air. So oxygen is there and this Fe and Mn will be getting oxidized. This does not require any chemical addition, require filter too. But after this aeration, a filter is needed to remove the oxidized Fe and Mn. Another one is catalytic carbon filter. The principle is the same. First oxidized Fe and Mn2, Fe3 plus and Mn4 plus. Then use the filter to filter the precipitate. Okay, here what is happening is this catalytic carbon filter first adsorb Fe and Mn, then oxidize, then filter the precipitate. Effective for dissolved Fe concentration less than 1 milligram per liter. Because if you have very low concentration and you wanted to bring down to 0.3 milligram per liter and etc., okay, this method can be used, but backwashing of the filter is essential because your precipitate will be soaking the carbon filter. So in between, backwashing is needed, and minimum DO required is 4 milligram per liter, because the first the iron and manganese is getting adsorbed there, then it has to be oxidized. So for that one, oxygen is needed. So minimum DO required is 4 milligram per liter. And another method of removing iron and manganese is ozonation. It is highly effective. Simultaneous removal of bacteria and organics also will be occurring, but only problem is it is expensive. Ozonation also, Fe3 plus and Mn4 plus will be formed and they will be precipitating out. Then you have to have a filtration system. Okay, so we have seen disinfection systems, okay, iron and manganese removal systems. Now we'll quickly go through defluoridation, because this is a major problem in India and in many other countries. So we'll see what all are the methods we can remove fluoride, because fluoride also commonly found in groundwaters. Okay, fluoride in drink water is a double-edged sword. Okay, it is having benefit as well as it creates adverse effect. Benefit, it helps in calcification of enamel in child in the concentration of 1.5 milligram per liter. So low concentrations of fluoride are good. That is the reason earlier days the toothpaste and all were supplemented by fluoride, but nowadays it is not being done. But adverse effects are more prominent at high concentrations. Fluoride can cause dental fluorosis and skeletal fluorosis. And where is this fluoride coming in the water? Okay, sources is from rocks and soil minerals. And what is the standard for fluoride? Okay, Bureau of Indian Standard is 1 milligram per liter. It is acceptable concentration and 1.5 milligram per liter allowable concentration. That means you should have up to 1 milligram per liter, that is acceptable. And if you cannot remove up to 1, you can have maximum is 1.5 milligram. Now we'll see what is a global and Indian scenario of this fluoride problem. Problems in more than 20 developed and developing countries. So fluoride problem is not only in India, it is a global problem. Severe high fluoride problems of India, China, Sri Lanka and Rift Valley of Africa exist. Fluoride problem is prevalent in 17 states in India, especially Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Gujarat and Uttar Pradesh. You can see all these blue marked areas, have fluoride problems. Okay, all these things have fluoride problems. So how, and India, this orange color shows 30 to 50% of the districts are affected by fluoride. Okay, you can see which all are the states getting affected. And green color shows 50 to 100% district affected by fluoride. Tamil Nadu and all are coming under that category. Okay, these are most severely affected states, and the next one is this orange. So that means the fluoride problem is widespread in India. Okay, so this is large number of fluoride contaminated water sources are present in Dharmaburi, Krishnagiri, Salem and Erode districts of Tamil Nadu. A 5 fluoride content of 9 milligram per liter recorded in Dharmaburi district against acceptable limit of 1 or 1.5 milligram per liter. So how does fluoride get mixed due to rainwater and continuous groundwater? Okay, so you can see that this is the rainwater and this is the fluoride bearing rocks and this is the groundwater. So what will happen? The groundwater is penetrating into the ground and the fluoride from the fluoride containing rocks are getting mixed with the groundwater. So when we extract the groundwater, this fluoride contaminated water will be coming through your wells or bore wells, etc., and you will be getting fluoride contaminated water. And what is the effects of fluoride? If fluoride concentration is 1.5 milligram per liter, no effect. 1.5 to 3 milligram per liter, tooth fluorosis. You can see how is your teeth, whether you have this type of horizontal brownish color patches, that shows that your water is having fluoride. And 3 to 6 slight skeletal fluorosis. If you consume water with more than 6 milligram per liter of fluoride, severe skeletal fluorosis can be happen. So you can see very less, yellowish color you can see. Again, patches are started coming, slight and severe. You can see that brownish, completely brownish color, that patches, and it is horizontal brown color, not the vertical line. Colors, vertical lines. Drinking continuously fluoride mixed water will lead to fluorosis. How does fluorosis happen? Drinking continuously. You drink only one glass of fluoride contaminated water, it is not going to cause any problem. But if you drink continuously fluoride mixed water, it will lead to fluorosis. Why fluoride content is observed more in few places? It is mostly present in rocks and soils which has fluoride mineral ore in it. So certain types of industrial wastewater also can cause fluoride, but mostly it is anthropogenic in, mostly it is natural in origin. That means fluoride containing minerals are causing the fluoride contamination in groundwater. We cannot cure fluorosis. This is very important. There is no medicine for curing that disease. So prevention is only the solution. So this is if the drinking water has fluoride concentration more than 1.5 milligram skeletal fluorosis. You can see the baby's, okay, this boy's, okay, leg. It is, okay, bent like this. This is skeletal fluorosis and this is dental fluorosis. You see this girl's teeth, how it is, okay. It is having that brownish patches in the teeth, okay. This is tooth fluoro, okay. It is very clear here how it is. And who are affected by fluorosis? It affects small children if he or she is fluoride contaminated water during the premolar stage. This disease will last for lifelong once it is happened. Okay. This is ordinary teeth, distorted teeth. You can see how it. Okay. This is skeletal fluorosis. You see, completely bent. What are the symptoms of skeletal fluorosis? Pain in neck and neck tissue compression, backbone pain and joint pain, bent in hand, leg bones, etc. And you can see that the deposition, okay, how fluoride will easily affect the bones made of calcium, okay. And skeletal fluorosis, not only human beings, even the animals can get the fluorosis, okay, if they drink fluoride contaminated water, okay. So now we will see, okay, how can we, okay, do the defluoridation. Defluoridation means the removal of excess fluoride in drinking water, okay. I think, okay, this part we will discuss in the next class, okay. I will stop here, okay. We will have an interaction for next 5 to 7 minutes. If you have any questions on disinfection chapter, disinfection portion, or iron and manganese removal, or anything related to fluoride contamination, okay, I'll try to clarify your doubts. Yeah, process to remove endocrine disrupting substances. Anyway, I'll be discussing about this one in the next class, tomorrow's class. But most of the endocrine disrupting compounds are organic in nature, mostly organic in nature. So adsorption is to some extent is applicable, but many of these compounds properties vary. Some are hydrophilic, some are hydrophobic. So you have to select appropriate adsorbents for the removal. Otherwise, if you go for reverse osmosis or those type of methods, okay, many of these endocrine disrupting compounds can be removed, or ion ozonation or plasma treatment also will remove your endocrine disrupting compounds, because many compounds are there. So some treatment will be effective for some compounds. Okay, so you have to have a combination of different treatment technologies. Any more questions from disinfection or iron and manganese removal? Okay, hope all of you understood how disinfection and pH of the water is related, because at acidic pH your disinfection will be much more effective compared to alkaline pH, because acidic pH HOCl will be more prominent, and HOCl is much more effective compared to OCl minus. Thus, RO purifies water containing fluoride components. Reverse, RO will be removing fluoride, okay, because fluoride, okay, most of the monovalent ions will be getting removed by RO. So RO treated water will be free of fluoride. There won't be any problem. I'll be talking about the fluoride removal mechanism in the next class, because now time is getting over. That's why I didn't cover that portion. I'll give you all the methods for fluoride removal. So if no more questions are there, I'm stopping here. Tomorrow 2 o'clock we'll meet again. Okay, we'll discuss about advanced water treatment and continue the leftover portion. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, you will be getting the lecture notes by email.